So our first presenter today is Sofia Simitzi. She is actually a professor of theology, but has her PhD and postdoc research in philosophy.
I'm a professor. I took those lessons in the University of Ioannina. I belong to Ministry of Education as a professor. Okay. We had a PowerPoint, but it has a problem, so we should continue. There's no problem. So you have to listen only. Okay. Well, the title of my thesis is Insight and Illusion, Philosophical Transactions of Keiji Nishitani, Crossing East and West Theoretical Borderlines. So everybody is able to see the abstract. Well, Keiji Nishitani's philosophy deals with Zen Buddhism, European philosophy, and Christian mysticism under the impact of existentialism. The philosopher adopts the ability to introspect the self and provides a detailed account of what it's like to be a human being, to remember Thomas Nagel's phrase. Nishitani's philosophical discussion of the self proceeds under two subheadings, the inside self and the concerning material outer self. Nishitani begins Religion and Nothingness, a major opus, by revealing that religion should not be understood in terms of theoretical depths or social utility, but in terms of the need human being has to turn to primordial level of being. The doctrine of transcendental illusion is clearly central to Nishitani's critique of metaphysics, and it plays an especially important role in his diagnosis of the errors of philosophy. More formally, he takes transcendental thoughts to be grounded in realities. The subjective necessity about which Nishitani speaks is the rational demand for a complete unity of thought or explanation, although in no way wants the rational demand for a complete and systematically unified knowledge. He does argue that reason is subject to an illusion that posits such systematic unity as already holding objectively of things themselves. For Nishitani, the purpose of phenomenological description was not to discover the structure of consciousness, but to make manifest the structure of our everyday being in the world. Nishitani reacted to Hegel's systematic and total account of human being and history in terms of rationality, arguing for the essential absurdity of human existence and the need for a fundamentally irrational but faithful and passionate commitment to religious form of life. Likewise, criticized the philosophical tradition emphasis on rationality as determining the passionate attachment to the world necessary to support a worthwhile life. This branch of existentialism was deeply influenced by Nietzsche's proclamation of the death of God. Like the phenomenology of Heidegger, Merleau-Ponty, and Sartre, existentialism as a movement starts its analysis with existing individual, the individual engaged in a particular world with a characteristic form of life. The horizon of perception, however, is not exhausted by the objects of immediate surroundings, which, though not currently perceived, are so co-present to consciousness. The universal horizon of the consciousness of particular items is consciousness of the world as an all-embracing whole. The world as a whole is always already given as certainly existing. This unquestioning belief in the real existence of the world as a whole is what Husserlian phenomenology calls the general thesis of the natural attitude. In the natural attitude, my consciousness is directed toward objects in the world in what phenomenology calls the intentionality of consciousness. As the name suggests, the life world is the world in which we live as we experience it, or at least its basic stratum, its passion, the temporal world of things as it is experienced in our pre-scientific life. The subjective and the relative life world is then thought to be something that must be overcome in favor of the being itself, with science purports to describe. But Nishitani thinks this is a mistake. It is the life world which gives rise to the question of science. It is the life world to which the scientist must ultimately appeal in answering such questions. The most pressing philosophical task is to help us cope with anxiety, despair, in such a way that we can affirm this life in all its absurdity. Therefore, the ideal human life will be authentic. At the core of it raises a question here. Does Nishitani, in his ultra-subjective point of thing, never really appreciating the need for a transcendental reduction, remains always in a danger of falling back into psychologism or monism? At the core of Nishitani proto-phenomenology is the strict correlation between being and consciousness. Whereas for Nishitani, the philosophy became inseparable from a certain kind of idealism with the transcendental method. thus interprets the philosophy of religion as ontology, or even ontotheology, understood as the study of being. Temporality is also one of the most important elements of all phenomenological problems, and also very difficult forms. The extractive unity of temporality as the final horizon of intelligibility and ontological understanding, the experience of the now and now time, this derivative of primordial futural temporality. With the collapse of Hegelian idealism and his thesis of philosophy at absolute Wissenschaft, the view had come to dominate the knowledge of reality. Is provided by and only by science, so that the only thing left for philosophy to do is to analyze scientific knowledge and to try to explain how it is possible. Philosophy becomes theory of knowledge, more specifically theory of scientific knowledge. In line with this conception of a rather limited role of philosophy, the thought of the Japanese thinker came to be seen as exclusively concerned with the theory of natural science. It asks, given the fact of natural scientific knowledge, what are the conditions of the possibility of such a knowledge? The philosophy of Nishitani is not epistemology, but mainly, as we mentioned before, ontology. It belongs to what we say in European philosophy, metaphysica generalis, being as a whole, that is the totality of what is dividing up into basic regions, God, nature, and human being. According to Nishitani, maintains that knowledge is primarily intuition, wrote at the beginning of the last stage of our cultures, living out of the Platonic promise that by becoming critical and pursuing detached theoretical understanding, one could arrive at certainty in knowledge, universality in things, and reacted against the Enlightenment, promised the reason. Disinterested objectivity and scientific truth would save our culture from dogmatism, superstition, and fanatism. Nishitani ties his philosophical view with the entire field of personal consciousness and within the stream of thought, both of the outer world and our own wild thinking. Therefore, Nishitani sees that somehow the self is felt as an active element of being that welcomes or opposes things insofar as they are phenomena, existential phenomena existing, revealing themselves to us. There is a sense of irony in Nishitani's thought, as I believe in all Japanese philosophy, as he confuses his own standpoint or experience with the object self and the illusion from which Nishitani suffers. His philosophical inquiry is critical in the Kantian sense, as he examines the kind of answers we are able or not to give the question, if life is worth living. I don't see how Nishitani can be saved from the absurdity of supposing that someone could experience a sensation and still remain question whether it is yours or that of someone else, or I am the same person that I speak today or someone else I was days before. This question has many implications. Nishitani's philosophy believes that all things lie in infinite experience, meaning and the self, and experience are everything as we are standing on a deeper and darker than any theory or method substratum. If I have been concerned to suggest that Keiji Nishitani thought is close to pragmatism, I should reply that it directs the question raised about the multiple forms of religious lives and the ways of thinking and to the idea that our knowledge is a system rooted in deeds and volitions. In Nishitani's philosophy is at least a theory of meaning, a holistic account of knowledge, maybe a try of a method to resolving disputes, and even a theory of truth, considering that the trail of human nihilism is overall. The Japanese philosopher was a sick soul in the sense coined by William James, meaning a person for whom darkness and despair gets its signings in the world. Nishitani has personal crises, periods of self-hatred, psychological uncertainties, and managed to express such experiences in philosophical work. Nishitani known very well that only religious or even heroic feelings are a cure for morbid fears, fundamental terror, emptiness, and dark thoughts, which are at the heart of human existence and living. I like to imagine him who has gotten up for a walk over the hillside, all of us with the blossom cherry trees, with a step straight and tired, and a greasy body with a bitter smile on the face, a little irony, like someone who saw for a moment the uncertainty of the spiritual odyssey of the man, with appreciative silence before the unfolding world of nature. In Nishitani, philosophical thought approaches Christianity with a Buddhist sense notion of non-self, which underlines that something like permanent self does not exist. The apophatic attitude means that it makes no sense to talk of absolute, unchangeable realities independent of our constructive act, reality which Nishitani describes in his philosophy as a continuous stream, with each part of it leading to the next and the boundaries for the human being fastened together. There are similarities between Nishitani with Western thought and Christianity. Surprising as this may be, European and Asian philosophies share many common philosophical patterns. By examining Nishitani's main points of his philosophical discourse, such nihilism, self-transcendence, whilst comparing these concepts to Zen, Buddhism, Taoism concepts, we will find that there are as well often contrasting and conflicting definitive conclusions between them. Nevertheless, certain similarities, such as the concept of the Buddhist notion of the non-self and the role of language and semiotics in their religion, and the Taoist role of universal nature, to name a few, make the studies of Nishitani significant. Well, as heard, we should say also that turning to Nishitani's philosophy of religion, self-negation is close to deity. It begins from the subjective starting point of the single individual. Nishitani developed a scheme for metaphysics and religion exclusively of human experience and rather apophatic. And in this path utilizes all the mechanisms he has previously developed to generate a balanced product of West and Eastern thought, where his principle of religious experience plays a major role. Nishitani connects also the Christian love, well, with the Buddhist great compassion. The via negativa, or apophatic way, or apophansis, it meaning in Greek, focuses on explaining the nature of a God by focusing what God is not. Apophatic comes from the Greek term to deny, apophancy, is based on the fundamental belief that God is beyond human understanding and description, so it will be felt. On the one level, he defines deity within the context of human experience. From this point of view, the chasm between transcendence and immanence, which causes an individual to accept the divine, illustrate the ontological relation between God and his creatures as a problem of Christianity, which according to Nishitani ought to be an existential issue for the pilgrim and religious man. Nishitani took the philosophical and religious enterprise both in West and East seriously, because he realized that along with meeting standards of intellectual adequacy, philosophy should provide us with mechanisms for interpreting reality usefully to the fulfillment of our high demands. Nishitani addresses virtually all the important issues of religious human being, and transformation is possible only when he doubts his own strength and volition. He points out that a clear distinction between philosophy and religion, which characterized the Western thought, and we pay a price for that, of course, is likened in the Japanese philosophy, where the enigmatic human self tends to fuse into the world of things. What is more, Nishitani's reflection on the absolute is inseparably connected with the reflection of the human condition of the world. The realization of absolute nothingness equals negation with a simultaneous affirmation. It means freedom from the dualism of life and death, from existential suffering in his bodily dimension. Nishitani formulates his own paradox interpretation of the term, which is some Japanese terms very familiar to all of you. Nishitani uses a concept of ecstasy when explaining the process of describing a being through its negation. And then Nishitani was critical of a Cartesian understanding of an abstract and immaterial cogito somehow suspended apart from the flesh, and recognized the philosophical importance of describing the lived ambiguity of human embodiment. But is it possible to distinguish between two principally different types of personality with two different genesis or eternal histories and with two modes of passivity and embodiment? What's so-called the problem of sexes? There is for Nishitani but one serious philosophical problem connected with active nihilism, and that is suicide. Judging whether life is or is not worth living amounts to answering the fundamental question of philosophy, and here's, I would say, right, the traditionally most fundamental question, the question of the nature of the benevolent life, makes the presupposition that there is such a thing as a well-living and is therefore logically posterior of death. Well, what does to have to say philosophy or science in the face of the abyss? We are incapable of knowing even the word death without negation. And the ontology, I want to mention, of nothingness does not involve the logic of negation and the construction of existence. Non-life and non-being are not ontological extensions. They are logical and dualistic negation of lives and beings. In an existential and biological sense, we are alive or dead, but in an ontological sense, we are the both. It is Nishitani's ground of ultimate reality that is empty and realized in nirvana. And then for Keiji Nishitani, the states of mystical intuition are actually sudden and great extensions of the field of the so-called consciousness, with the threshold of waking awareness a fall into the abyss, however caused produce of a powerful influx of previously hidden data, breaching the seemingly secure boundaries of the self. To what extent can mystical experiences legitimately authorize philosophical or theological positions? Perhaps more seriously, there have been raised questions as to whether moments of knowledge by acquaintance can be designed as a moment of knowledge at all. According to him, ineffability is one of the most profound criteria by which the mystic labels experiences, and also a phenomenological characteristic. But what has priority for Nishitani, the experience of nothingness or the outcomes of the mystic? Nishitani makes a daring link between his religious investigation and his metaphysical options. Therefore, nothingness becomes a way into ontology, so a beginning of a methodology. However, any attempt to realize in depth Nishitani's philosophy is made complex because of several conceptions of the self as transitory, intertwined with the physical body, and epiphenomenal. Nishitani has an antipathy towards any conception of the soul. And then the question arises, if self, body and mind fall away, what is left for of the existence and being on the world of the world? What does it mean ontologically to live the death of emptiness? And also, at the end, Nishitani felt that one of the crucial features of a worthwhile philosophy in the mid of 19th century in Japan and universally in West presupposes a real connection with life, as he realized the tendency to lose the human in a world industrial, cosmopolitan and postmodern. The question he posed are relevant specifically to our present concerns about the relationship between science, technology and human. He considered philosophy to be permanently an expression of the concrete empirical conditions of human existence. He critiques the use of technology and the ability to manipulate the laws of nature as contributing to the self-centeredness of humankind. And then for each philosophical question, Nishitani addresses he uses his principle of emptiness to clear up the philosophical field. Thus, he holds that nihilism leads naturally to a metaphysical pluralism and a specific theory of reality, truth and meaning. The motivation behind Nishitani's thought is unquestionably experiential and maybe moral. He emphasized the fuller significance of thought as philosophical ideas derived from purposes, interests, and they would answer to them. His philosophical theory begins from the subjective point of the individual. He sees solitude and nihilistic agony, self-deception as anti-life, and strives to face his abyss. Anti-life is, of course, for him something very twisted for European thought. Nishitani's effort to refuse to mask or to hold theoretical hope for removing the suffering, the fear that is permanent characteristic of life, those dimensions of human reality so dramatically described, cannot be avoided via escapist externalism or temporal hedonisms or any attempt. And then, as he once put it, the fundamental problem of my life has always been, put simply, the overcoming of nihilism through nihilism. And then it is the evil thing, meaning in the tradition of Martin Heidegger or even Ralph Waldo Emerson and many others, and above all himself, is dedicated to forming a philosophy that is disciplinary, that is for service not only to the specialists. How does evil exist in the world? The evil, something fundamental, real, may be an element of natural freedom. When considering the issue of evil, Nishitani focuses on the contradiction of Christianity, which deals with God's goodness and the presence of evil in the world. To this question, Nishitani gives a Buddhist rather answer when he states that the suffering caused by this contradiction is caused by the dualism of good and evil in which a man lives. Nishitani's nihility is rather requiem, though which signals the collapse of the Western symbolic order of things, and manifests a radical nihilism with active elements, something totally different from the Europeans, as a sign of a human historical spirit. For Nishitani, religious research becomes central in that because it would attest the ultimate human experience and scientific claim. And his theory of nihility provides the theoretical background for his account of reality and truth, so it will be a beginning of gnosiology. And then, would the fundamental cause of the present alienation, mainly in the West from cultural heritage and religion, be globalization, technology, or derives from a deep nationality, as Nishitani made clear? It seems that it's not the existence of the human being which is threatening with the destruction, but the crisis, but the quality of human life, that the human being will be doomed to survive as something other or less than human. The philosopher's suggestions are so difficult, almost tortuous. We cannot look so deep inside, so wildly. And absolutely, for such an attempt to remove the nihilism is required a kind of heroic, almost with suicidal power essence. Do we have that? Also, in the text of the philosopher, there are no sex views or a generalization that forces you to everything and ask for everything. In a complete sense of human with feelings of fear, leaving the philosopher exposed to questions of political thought and criticism. Nishitani firmly links the existence and the phenomenon by offering a psychological description of the real being yourself, but who is the self? We look furiously in another mirror, another look, perhaps more pure and primitive, that only the religion at its limit and the art at its maturity can give. How would such a human quality manifest today by the Japanese thinker with the help of religion? In this utopian thinking of the things and of the human beings, Nishitani presupposes a method project which is defined as a way of thinking that allows us to study an era without the restrictions of our current reality. In such a moment of reorientation of thinking, a utopian moment occurs, and the challenge for religion is deeper than showing the validity of its truth claims. Nishitani taught that the key to a philosopher in his vision of things, his mode of feeling the whole push and the journey of life for the sick soul, as Nishitani was, is to overcome the emptiness. But how can the sick soul be reborn? The errors that Nishitani diagnoses are not mistakes in reasoning so much as their defects of vision derived from the human desire to transcend the human, as always know. And so the word religion becomes a collective name of essences. The writings are almost never quite simple. Therefore, identify as a proto-phenomenological attempt to describe human experience pretheoretically. Undoubtedly, there is a great snare of Nishitani's philosophy, a rather psychologist fallacy, is the confusion of his own standpoint, such as self and nihilism, with that of the fundamental fact which is making his report. And then, this encounter necessarily is always a tense and contentious one. Now, of course, even the Buddhist teacher will acknowledge the perils and dangers of a spiritual journey, maybe without return. But all of this resistance is ultimately seen as a part of the illusory process of the false self. Illusions, then, where and how do they arise from? Nietzsche saw in the abyss the promise of the overman, and he went mad. Others, like Pascal, choose the Christian dogmatism. For Sartre or others, existentialist mainly, nihilism was ultimately materialistic and absurd because without meaning. Well, this is the logical conclusion of Western metaphysics and also the starting point, maybe, for a new spiritual essence like the Buddhism to the Europeans. The existentialists could not reach the abyss of nihility as a positive experience because they did not equate nothingness with the powers of life. It is a logical explanation. Modernity gives us an abyss of choice, resulting in schizophrenic self-split. Experience as such does not ask for an ideological permission. It happens. And then, I don't see how the whole world is mad or oblivious to the fact, which is worse, nihilism, deconstruction. Heidegger saw Western metaphysics, which is his mentor, in many ways, are ways of getting through madness. And say Western metaphysics has the history of the self-splitting of being into ontic beings and the self-getting of the self-splitting in Oriental, however metaphysics. On the other hand, we could say that the holism and unity are the preference starting point. Buddhist metaphysics preaches the self-presencing of the groundless ground of reality in the constant unity of being nothingness. I don't see how Nishitani can be rescued from the illusion of supposing that I could experience a sensation and question whether it's mine or that of someone else. Increasing numbers of philosophers today are drawn to Nishitani's philosophy, not only because he's one of the most vital representatives of Japan's richest movement, meaning Kyoto-School, but more importantly because he provides an imaginative and fruitful approach to many problems and their solutions. Nishitani addresses all the important issues in philosophy, both in West and East, in a balance, and he wrote classical work in religion as well. To all the issues he addresses bring a degree of provocativeness unrevealed yet in the literature. The researcher cannot be stand outside the inquiry. Instead, he's drawn into a vivid dialogue with a man of wisdom, sensitivity, and of course, a profound sense of what is important for real life. Thank you. It would be richest with some PowerPoint, but...
So now we have 15 minutes for questions and please.
Quite interesting. I'm not 100% sure that I agree with all the interpretations in the case.
That's the issue, do not agree.
I think one of the key things I want to bring out is when Nishitani and Keiji, it's a mistake to think of nothingness as simply a kind of negation and it's a mistake to think of nothingness as kind of otherwise than being. You should be imagining the certain religion and nothingness that being nothingness, and also the idea of sunyata as ultimately not just a great negation, but also the great affirmation whereby one gets to the other side and crosses through to this idea of suchness or thusness, which, as I talked about in my presentation, has been quite an entire case of thingness. It's that idea of just things being or nothingness.
You don't agree with those sharps, those sharps borders between them, it's an option.
No, I kind of felt that your talk missed out that it also made Nishitani sound much more bleak and depressing than he actually is. Because I see him as ultimately more helpful, although as you say, he's a sick soul, but he's more helpful, I think.
Well, it's a provocative term, just to say it, and I believe it. Of course, it needs a lot of arguments to have the audience accept those options, like the sixth soul. But the sixth soul is a whole philosophical anthropology before over it. But okay, I think his main motive is moral. I think also that many terms like nihilism or even transcendentalism or even the self is methodological keys. I think he is attempting to make a metaphysical system, but in very early beginning. Something which I think happens to all Japanese thought of Kyoto School. Because what they have is a huge European building of thinking. And how to stand beside it without do something like methodology, which is very important, and I think he's trying to make something like that. It is my option. Of course, needs many arguments. I think some of them exist here.
Not sure.
That's the point. In philosophy.
I sort of say that Nishitani is saying, the thing is, he's what led him to Kyoto-School thinking, in a sense, he's trying to reclaim Buddhism or Japanese thought from the far side of Europeanization or the far side of Westernization. And so, in a sense, the far side of metaphysics or the far side of any ground being or ground nothingness. Metaphysics for Nishitani Keiji or
But we agree that the human being, the condition of the human being, is the main substratum for the Kyoto School.
Yeah.
We agree for that.
Or no? Yeah. Well, anyway, we need to talk
about that. Okay.
Any other question or comment?
Yes, I think you gradually mentioned the overcoming of nihilism.
Well,
very important point for Nishitani. When a typical Western thinker first faces Kyoto School and other forms of Asian thought, I think that's a long line coming from the Yamaka philosophy and Nagarjuna to Dogen and then to Kyoto School. And they are very fond of contradictions, and this is very surprising for a Western way of thought. Then sometimes I wonder whether it would be better to use different words. For example, of course, there is a Nietzschean nihilism. He thinks it's not correct, so we must, in a way, überwinden. We must go through this kind of nihilism to another kind of nihilism.
I agree.
Two very different kinds. Mm. Then why keep the same name to mention two so different things?
Mm.
Probably the nihilism Nishitani presents as a new step could be first better described as, you know, something like a new state that we can arrive to, something mentioning, for example, his notion of transcendence, you know, when nirvana in some way comes to samsara, something we find in Nagarjuna and found in Nishida before, and then you could express what he wants to say about his own kind of nihilism without using the word nihilism, and I think it would be clear.
It would be clear.
Western way of thinking.
Yes, yeah, that you have a right. I think so. Maybe he is trying to be more systematic. He's tried to make a bridge with European thought, so he ought to some terms to give another sense. Also, he has an experience of European living. And also, something which we are not able to forget, we should see the text in their historical framework. I don't know if he is here now with us, if he insists in the same terms, with the same sense. And if we all understand the same thing. So it comes before us a lot of thinking about the meaning, and you have so right about the terms we use. Do we communicate the same things? I really doubt, because we maybe live in a Western paradise or in an Eastern nirvana, in a very light and very calm societies, but we don't. Something is wrong.
Okay.
Because I have understand Christian, because Titanian, it's right that Titanian is a space of emptiness, and it's in the last, coming nearer and nearer to the beginning, and also that comes more and more details inside, and it goes different to the point becoming the end and the beginning. It's going in space coming together.
Yes, you have a right. We have a spatial temporality, uniqueness, meaning in Greek it means, I said to the Greek word, well, systole to chron, meaning the time and the space become one sudden. It's a primordial level, an element of what here in the professor loved say the day before. It's about a kind of how can he says that also, but with the different words, something with this an essence of the beginning and the ending simultaneously, something which demands, this is mine, also the bodily dimension. It's not without it, I think. It's not without this. Nishitani does not talk, and even the whole Kyoto school, I think, does not talk only with spiritual elements. He puts in his writings the essence of the bodily things. He has before his eyes himself and the real life, the experience of a real life, for me, I think. That's why we're reading him again and again, because he is a real person. He's a real writing about real things, about death, about body, about self, about which is, and don't mention it that because it will go far, far longer way, about the things who have to do, which has to do with the personal identity. I think in his writings I found a lot of things that gives me an essence of Lockean empiricism about qualities and the sense data, which I don't mention that because it is weird. Going far away. Okay.
Yeah, any other questions? Comments?
We've done?
4 minutes left, but yeah.
Okay.
Then, thank you very much again.
Thank you.